Marriage is not easy. Life is generally easier when one is single. No need for long consultation before making decisions. No scares of broken hearts. No power tussle or power play of any kind to assert authority. No fear of being isolated. With marriage, even when you think you have done your very best, your spouse can creatively find a way to make you wrong. These are my views anyway. My twin sister had issues in her home and was pushed out by another woman who bewitched her husband. Having nowhere else to go, she came over to my place. My elder brother's place is off limits because he is currently dealing with his own marital storm.
My place
is the preferable calm abode. Maybe that is because my marriage is much younger in less than 2 years.
Why are you coming with this much load? Oh yeah, tell me.
I will tell you everything.
Tell me, please, tell me.
Dear, you know what you're doing is not the right thing. Are you forgotten about our
agreement? Before marriage, my wife and I came to a decision that we won't allow anyone, be it family member or friend, tag along our marital crosses at any point in time. We kept to that decision. I never envisaged that our current situation might occur. Perhaps we both weren't being totally rational with the belief that our marriage could be a solitary island. Tension arose between my sister and my wife, and within the first few days, there was an open confrontation between both women.
Am I supposed to move your daughter?
Daniela,
move.
Surprisingly, that disagreement resulted to my wife moving out of the home to only God knows where, at the end of the week, just like that. I tried my best to reconnect with her and convince her to come back home, but she kept rejecting my cause. I had to offload my sister somewhere else, one of our lady family friends, in order for my wife to return home from her almost 2 weeks absence, but to no avail.
I don't know why my wife is behaving this way. I don't even know how we are about to make the matter worse. She's not picking my calls.
Daniel, to be sincere with you, there is nothing I or anybody in the family can do about this. We've tried convincing her to come back home, but she refused. And she's not disclosing her location to us too.
If I know this,
but for what I gathered, she went in where she was.
I gathered from her sister that she rented an apartment for herself in an undisclosed location and isn't interested in coming home. With my wife whereabouts unknown, my urgent calls to her rejected, I am still living in isolation 2 months after.
Kevin, you're welcome. Today is a continuation of what we had before, and we were talking about isolation. Okay, just a quick recap so you'd know where we stopped and where we're taking off from. We stopped at the position where we said, in as much as some decisions have been made, and one of our guests said they were not cast stone decisions. I like that word, cast stone decisions. And the other one said, make provision for extended times, for changes, for times where it's different. So we're taking off on that note, and we still have the same seasoned guest we had before to continue this. Sir, you're welcome.
Thank you so much. Good day, viewers.
Emma, you're welcome.
Thank you very much. Good day, viewers.
I hope. Okay, there's something I want to talk about. There is this, sometimes we give people the impression that we want to do some things. How do you, in counseling, in suggesting, in giving help, how do you make a point on what you're saying? Because if, for instance, the sister was calling, oh, you're starting it again today, oh, this one has happened today, and you act like, why don't you just leave the house? Just go somewhere, anywhere you can go. When you say that, your place is anywhere. So you give instructions and help where you don't give an impression, you make a good statement with your suggestions.
Okay. The Bible says, what God has joined together, let no man put asunder. It is not Christ-like. It is not the wish or the will of Christ for any marriage to break or for couples to live separately. No, it is not the will of God. So, at any point in time when issues arise in marriage, you, as the person being consulted, you are in the position of ensuring that you mend ways, that those things that are broke, that have broken or that are breaking, you must mend them. And it is not permitted at any point in time, except in situations where you realize that these things are life-threatening, that, okay, if proper care is not taken, this person, they could lose his or her life. You could advise. You can only advise. You can't even mandate it. Please step aside for this period while we try to restitute between you and your spouse. So at every point in time, we must be seen trying to ensure that we mend the fence, we mend things that are going sour.
Yeah.
So that is my take on it.
Okay. He said something, he said, except it's in life-threatening situations.
Yeah.
Okay, and that brings me to the next thing I want to talk about. Ma, do you think there's any justifiable ground for Joy living at home? Is this a justifiable ground? Is this a life-threatening issue? And how she went, how far is too far?
Okay. You and I know it's not a life-threatening thing.
Okay.
Good. Good enough, it was really bad. But for Christ's sake, this is your home. You don't have to run away when there are issues. Rather, you sit down and talk it over. You know, first of all, it has to start with communication. You must allow your partner know your pains, what you're going through. You understand? And if possible, show him way out. Suggest to him that, look, I'm burning up on the inside of me. Let the man know your feelings and help him out the much you can. And it's not by packing to wherever. God hates divorce. God hates separation.
You call it temporary separation. But then,
you've already sent a signal. Whether you like it or not.
And they was going to put on it.
A wrong signal for that matter. So it's the first thing is not to take off. This is your home. You don't take off. If there are issues, rather you sit down and think of how to solve that problem.
I was even thinking that money she used to rent a house. If she was renting,
you can
a house
rent it, but I won't rent it for the lady.
For Daniela.
Please, I've got a place. That's why I said she could suggest, you know, she could also make moves to make sure. Of course, the person, whether you like it or not, is an intruder.
Yeah.
Even if it's your twin brother or you were born the same minute, he's already an intruder in her home. So if I were in her shoes, that money with which I went to rent a place, I will rent. I will make every provision to make sure that you are comfortable as much as is within my means. I will suggest if I have an account, if there's money, I will release it because I need my peace. I will buy my peace by all means, not running away. You face the situation. If your husband is saying, oh, there's no money, I have money. There's no this. You make provision as much as you can.
I think it's that
if you have.
Examination.
Yeah,
going is not an option. Leaving is not an option. If you remove it as an option, if you remove that it's not an option, then
you
can make clear decisions.
Yes. You could suggest as many possible ways of, you know, taking care of the situation.
I think it's that because for one, I used to have this mind of, if marriage is not good, everybody fight their level.
No.
Until the word of God started renew my mind.
Yes.
And I started, okay, I want to please God, I want to obey what God says. I think it's something that should happen in our mind. When you're married, what God has joined together, you don't be the one to put asunder. Because sometimes someone say put asunder, we think of a third person putting asunder. Mm-hmm. But couples could do that.
Yeah.
Because you can do
in
that.
In that case, she has already put herself asunder.
Okay, but on the part of you coach people on relationships, on marriages. There was this friend of threatening decisions, because that's what she did. She wanted to make a mark, and it's almost like looking like she had what she wanted. Like if she had not left, because now when we was talking about the communication in the home, I want to believe that it's not completely cut out that they've talked about this, and how many times too we don't know. There could be a couple of times. But then, because she was not being listened to, she was not being attended to, like we know women need attention, absolutely. You know, she wants to make a mark, an impression on this. How safe, how threatening is this kind of decision? Threatening decision. If you don't do this, I will do that.
A man or a woman who understands that, the Bible says for this reason, shall a man leave his father's house and cleave unto his wife, and the two of them shall become one. When, as a man, you are able to identify your wife as the better half of you, you are able to understand that taking her out of you, that makes you to be incomplete, and ditto the woman as well, then there wouldn't be any reason or any need for you to threaten or for you to embark on threatening decisions. There is no justification for it. Biblically, it is wrong.
Yeah.
You don't do that. When you threaten, what if your threat is just an empty one and eventually something negative happens? How do you justify? How do you exonerate yourself? To me, there is no ground that allows such. You must always be able to see your spouse as part of you. You must be able to understand that when I do, even to threaten, not to the level of threatening, when you do something to provoke your wife, or when you do something to infuriate your husband, you should see that I'm infuriating myself. I'm getting myself worked up unnecessarily. And all of these things could even cause an elderly rivalry within the house. There is just no need for either party, be it the husband or the wife, to embark on such things as far as I'm concerned. I don't encourage couples on it, be it pre-marriage or during the marriage. I don't encourage couples on that. You must always sit together, discuss things. Dialogue is very key, and that is communication.
But what's the point? I'm going to consider, sir. Ma, I want to shed more light on this. What's the point of why you were talking? What got into my mind was manipulative decision. You know, I used to think, okay, now I'm soft. I tear a lot. You don't need to cry. I won't do it here. But I tear a lot. I really can be very emotional. I thought it was normal, like just who I am, until I heard a message on it that that can make people make manipulative decisions. A friend is counseling you and then you're just tearing. You stop the person from talking. So as a woman, how do you stand firm to make firm decision? A conversation is going on, you're not tearing, you're strong. How do you do that? How can you build that firmness? So you don't infer the decision, you don't manipulate the decision, because that's also threatening too.
Yeah.
Yes.
As a woman, you must first of all be firm on your words, but to an extent. You must be able to understand who your husband is. Not to the point of, you know, threatening, saying all kinds of things. You should be able to understand the man and flow along that line. You understand? Like this issue that is before us, the woman, I don't think she exploited all available options before making her decision. And so you're able to know your man and exploit all available means. If this happened and you discover you've been talking and he's not listening, okay, did you take a further step? Did you talk to somebody he will listen to? We're not told he did anything like that. Okay. You have to exploit as many options as possible before you take your decision. Even after exploration. You don't have to leave as a child of God.
Yeah.
Because you have nowhere.
You don't have to leave.
You don't have to leave.
And you have to remember that God is for you.
Yes,
God
exactly.
is for you.
You even take it to God
you
in prayer.
Take it back. You have to know that. But right now, it's been a very, very, very sensitive topic. Almost like we cannot end it. Right now, we have to go on a short break. And when we come back, we will be concluding this section. Hello, you welcome back. Before we went on the break, we were talking about the firmness of a woman in decision process. Do not manipulate, not with your tears or vice versa, many others that we do, we know. Okay, right now, one look at, they talk about not having a third person, a third third party, third tier, third tier of government, I don't know. But having a third person in your marriage, does that include having a strong voice, godly, someone you listen to as a couple, does that include that?
Or exclude.
Exclude or include, anyhow you want to explain it. Mm-hmm. The third party includes someone you listen to. The Bible says, in the multitude of counsel, there is safety. Telling someone, this is what I'm going through, is it a third party something?
Okay, in marriage, yes, it is always advised that don't allow third party interference into your marriage. However, there are some things that you know that are beyond your control. Not allowing third party interference into your marriage does not mean when things are going beyond your control. First of all, you need to include, you must ask for the intervention of the Holy Spirit.
That's it.
You pray in tongues as a Christian, because you generate power when you pray in tongues.
Mm.
Holy Spirit will direct you to the right person.
Yes,
there will always be the right person for every situation, especially situations that are beyond you. Maybe your pastor, a seasoned and godly counselor, they can be of help. You can walk up to them based on divine leading. So you don't just say, no, I don't want to allow a third party interference into my marriage, and you see things fall apart. No, 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 no. It shouldn't be to that
extent.
That is an extreme situation.
Yeah,
you're like going over the board.
Yeah.
Yeah. That's the way I see it.
Well, you've been nodding your head, but please contribute to this. That's the word you've been.
The truth is that you don't have to allow, like he rightly said, you don't have to allow it go to that you know, extent. You must know at what level, at what point you speak out.
Yes.
Yeah, there are some you can easily manage, but when you know it's going beyond your level, then you speak out, like you actually said. First to the Holy Spirit, add prayers. Let prayers be going on in your mind. And if you see that it's still lingering, of course, look for somebody. There's somebody somewhere that somebody listens to.
Yes.
He may even have close partners or even relations that he can't. When they say something, you'll be able to reason, okay, it's true. You know, you must look for a counselor, your pastor, whoever, that you can offload whatever is on the inside so that you don't die before your time. You know, this keeping silent, you don't want anybody to hear what is happening in my home, you will die in silent. You die, they bury you, next person comes in.
Even Bible says that there's nothing that is hidden that will not be brought to the
open. Now, at the end of the day, everybody will now
know
what you are hiding. So there must be allowance for, you know, third party when it has gone beyond your level. What counselors normally say is, it's not everything you carry out
every
minute per second, you know. But when you see that it has gone beyond the your point where you can bear, then you shout out, you scream, and let the world know.
Okay, you scream and let the world know.
Yeah.
And like she said also, the person you're speaking to should be somebody that should be able to contribute to your marriage.
Exactly.
Not just anyone.
No, not just anyone.
I heard of a couple, of a lady, one of the partners, she was taking everything that was happening at home to her elder sister.
Mm.
And this is the sister in question. I was telling her, like, this person is not giving you biblical counsel. She's just talking from her own opinion.
Mm-hmm.
Worst of all, she's not in marriage.
Ah.
And elder sister, mother position, excuse me, keep it somewhere and get, if you must talk to someone that would add
value,
that will make it better. I think the third party thing is anybody that is not contributing to the marriage, that's where the third party position comes in. Okay. Okay, but we're still moving in this. I'm going to wrap up on this. Apart from this cause of isolation, there are other many causes of isolation. I know of one. I'm not married, but I know of one. Okay, there is a situation of too much spaced apartment. That's one I know.
Mm-hmm.
I'm not married. So our coach tell us more, and our homie will conclude on things that can cause isolation that should be avoided.
Okay, several things could cause isolation in marriage. One of them is lack of communication.
That's number one.
If you are not communicating, if you are not encoding, and your wife, your spouse is not decoding, there is no communication. There is gap or break in communication. That, by default, could lead to isolation. Another part to it is attention deficit. If you are not giving sufficient attention to your wife, naturally, women are wired to be attended to. My wife wants my attention, especially when I'm around. She will tell you, honey, why not just drop this laptop? When a woman is telling you that indirectly, you know she needs your attention. You don't need a prophet to tell you that. You should drop whatever you are doing. Give her the attention. When we talk about communication, we talk about attention. The third thing that I think one can do to avoid isolation in marriage is constant care. Care for your spouse. Spoil her with good gifts. Give her surprise packages. Let her, the things that she's not even aware of. Women like suspense a lot. Positive ones.
Yeah.
They don't need to announce it to you. By the time you do all of those, you keep your home together, your wife is at your end, the two of you will continue to sing from the same hymn book, and things will never fall apart. Neither would there be any issue like isolation.
Okay.
Wow. I think what he has said, I could take it the other way around.
Okay.
Same thing applies to the woman. Know your spouse. Spoil him as much as you can.
Mm-hmm.
You shouldn't be one-sided issue.
Okay.
Aha. Know what entices him. Those things engage him as much as you can. Whatever he's around, make sure, you know, he feels, oh, he's the king of this family. I mean, he's coming to his palace,
yeah,
and all that. You spoil him as much as you can. His meal, his, the home, the family, let him everywhere be homely, warmly, so that as he's coming from work, he's looking, you know, he's envisaging what's the next thing that, you know, I'm going to, what's the next excitement I'm going to get at home. Yes, because if he comes and he sees you as it was in,
yeah,
the beginning,
so
now, it makes, you know, before you know it, it's just, so what's there? There's nothing there,
yeah,
you know? It removes the joy, you know, so you need to serve, put all the ingredients to make the man, you know, work towards making him happy, just the same way he's working towards making you happy. And
okay,
there'll be no isolation
okay
whatsoever.
Wow, that's been wonderful, Salma. Thank you very, very, very much. Well, right now we're going to believe, and I want you to tell Mr. Daniel, if he's out there, final word, phrase.
Okay.
Or sentence.
Mr. Daniel, I believe you can hear us. Please. Your marriage is your life. Do all you can to ensure that your wife comes back home. Do all you can to ensure that you restitute and ensure that you live in harmony and tranquility with your wife. A failed marriage is a failed life.
Okay.
Okay. Let me talk to the wife.
Yes.
Enough of those gimmicks, enough of those plays. Make sure you return back to your home. Your home is your home. You don't have another one. As a child of God, that is your home. So, enough of those things and look forward to how you can come back to that home and make the home work.
Okay, so you read it all. And from my end, forgiveness is never too much. And seek to please God. And if you do that, every other thing will fall into place. And with that, I will be saying bye for now. And sir, you're very much welcome. Thank you very much. And ma, saying thank you very much. You made today possible. We appreciate you so much. Okay, and also viewers at home, like I said before, that's how much we can take. You can follow us on our social media platform showing on the screen. Leave your comments, leave your suggestions, leave your questions. We're back here to attend to you, and that makes us better, you know. Yeah. I've been your host, Abigail Sarah. Bye for now.